The Night and the Music, the Matthew Scudder Stories by Lawrence Block, narrated by the author.
Looking for David. Elaine said, "You never stop working, do you?" I looked at her. We were in Florence, sitting at a tile-top table in the Piazza di San Marco, sipping cappuccino every bit as good as the stuff they served at the Peacock on Greenwich Avenue. It was a bright day, but the air was cool and crisp, the city bathed in October light. Elaine was wearing khakis and a tailored safari jacket, and looked like a glamorous correspondent, or perhaps a spy. I was wearing khakis, too, and a polo shirt, and the blue blazer she called my old reliable. We'd had 5 days in Venice. This was the second of 5 days in Florence, and then we'd have 6 days in Rome before Alitalia took us back home again. I said, "Nice work if you can get it." "Uh-uh," she said, "I caught you. You were scanning the area the way you always do." I was a cop for a lot of years. I know, and I guess it's a habit a person doesn't outgrow. And not a bad one, either. I have some New York street smarts myself, but I can't send my eyes around a room and pick up what you can. And you don't even think about it. You do it automatically. I guess, but I wouldn't call it working. "When we're supposed to be basking in the beauties of Florence," she said, "and exclaiming over the classic beauty of the sculpture in the piazza, and instead you're staring at an old queen in a white linen jacket 5 tables over, trying to guess if he's got a yellow sheet and just what's written on it, wouldn't you call that working?" "There's no guesswork required," I said. "I know what it says on his yellow sheet." "You do?" "His name is Horton Pollard," I said, "if it's the same man, and if I've been sending a lot of looks his way, it's to make sure he's the man I think he is. It's well over 20 years since I've seen him. Probably more like 25. I glanced over and watched the white-haired gentleman saying something to the waiter. He raised an eyebrow in a manner that was at once arrogant and apologetic. It was as good as a fingerprint. "It's him," I said. "Horton Pollard. I'm positive." "Why don't you go over and say hello?" "He might not want that." 25 years ago, you were still on the job. What did you do, arrest him?" "Uh-huh." "Honestly? What did he do? Art fraud? That's what comes to mind, sitting at an outdoor table in Florence, but he was probably just a stock swindler." "Something white collar, in other words." "Something flowing collar, from the looks of him. I give up. What did he do?" I'd been looking his way, and our glances caught. I saw recognition come into his eyes, and his eyebrows went up again, in that manner that was unmistakably his. He pushed his chair back, got to his feet. "Here he comes," I said. "You can ask him yourself." "Mr. Scudder," he said. "I want to say Martin, but I know that's not right. Help me out." "Matthew, Mr. Pollard, and this is my wife, Elaine." "How fortunate for you," he told me, and took the hand she extended. I looked over here and thought, what a beautiful woman. Then I looked again and thought, I know that fellow. But then it took me a minute to place you. The name came first, or the surname at any rate. His name's Scudder, but how do I know him? And then, of course, the rest of it came to me, all but your first name. I knew it wasn't Martin, but I couldn't sweep that name out of my mind and let Matthew come in. He sighed. It's a curious muscle, the memory. Or aren't you old enough yet to have found it so? My memory's still pretty good. Oh, mine's good, he said. It's just capricious. Willful, I sometimes think. At my invitation, he pulled up a chair from a nearby table and sat down. But only for a moment, he said, and asked what brought us to Italy, and how long we'd be in Florence. He lived here, he told us. He'd lived here for quite a few years now. He knew our hotel on the east bank of the Arno and pronounced it charming and a good value. He mentioned a cafe just down the street from the hotel that we really ought to try. Although you certainly don't need to follow my recommendations, he said, or Michelin's either. You can't get a bad meal in Florence. Well, that's not entirely true.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.